in that reaction, am I saying, I want to honor God?
Yeah.
And unfortunately, I've got to say, many times I don't. Mm-hmm. Many times I react inappropriately. Mm-hmm. And I've got to, you know, go back and God, I'm sorry.
Yeah, yeah.
Why did I do that?
Yeah, me too.
But if I act His way and according to His will, I already know that leads to life. Over time, really coming to understand this is a much better way for me to live.
Yeah, definitely.
You know, that old way doesn't lead to life. It leads to me being sorry again. And I don't want to be that.
Yeah.
Let's take the path that leads to life.
All right. Hello, everyone. Welcome to episode 7. I was about to say season 7. Episode 7 of season 2 of The Lesson.
2 years from now, we'll be in season 7.
From The Lesson Podcast. I'm Ashley Key, Gordon Robertson, and we are very honored to be with you today. Today, we are talking about something very deep and spiritual.
Well,
no, I'm really, well, I mean, I'm somewhat joking, but I'm just, yeah, we're talking about the fear of the Lord, people. And I feel like whenever I say fear of the Lord, it just has like this weight and this power, because a lot of people are afraid of the fear of the Lord and are confused as to what exactly that means.
Even when you're not afraid of God, just the expression, the fear of the Lord's got weight to it.
True.
So why does it have that?
Because the Lord is big.
Okay.
The Lord is creator of the universe. The Lord is Alpha and Omega. The Lord is the Ancient One. The Lord is...
How about an all-consuming fire?
Yeah. The Lord is that.
The one who will judge.
Mm-hmm.
The lawgiver.
Yep.
The judge.
Mm-hmm.
The one who has the ability to destroy your soul.
Mm. Mm-hmm.
To get, oh, you're pushing it.
Yes, I'm pushing it.
She's the mumble alert.
No, I just noticed the distance. I'm like, oh no, the mic.
Ashley is my boredom barometer, and now my mumble alert. So I'll enunciate.
No, yeah.
There's an awesome power here.
Yeah.
And it's, you know, in my earthly existence, I guess the comparison is you're ushered into the presence of your grandfather and mm-hmm. you're 5 years old.
Okay, you know, yeah, yeah.
Okay, here's the guy that all of this is coming from. And
yeah.
I now, 5 years old, come into His presence. You know, you got to be on your mm-hmm. P's and Q's. You got, you know, they would dress me up for me to meet Granddaddy.
And let me just say, what was the first name of your Granddaddy?
A period. That's what he went by. But
his name was pretty powerful, like in general, right?
Willis?
Willis, or no, on your dad's side.
On my dad's side, it was A. Willis Robertson, because he didn't like his first name.
Well, okay.
And he was named for his grandfather.
Okay.
Absalom.
Absalom. Willis. I mean, that name right
there
will evoke.
Of all the names from the Bible to pick for your child, Absalom is probably not the best one.
But that name right there.
In my family line, they did that, and yeah. why they did. I mean, there's another relative I have who's Archelaus.
Oh my gosh.
Which is another word from the Bible. It means ruler of the people. And why would you name? Today, Archie. You know, it just doesn't make any sense.
Mm-hmm.
Unusual names back in my background.
I mean,
and some of them, and since Gordon being one, mm-hmm. Harrison being one, Willis mm-hmm. being one, Churchill being another one, you look at that legacy,
mm-hmm.
And there's a reason these names get repeated through the generations.
Hmm.
It's because of the legacy. It's honoring mm-hmm. the legacy.
Yeah, for sure. Well, I just say that to say, I mean, if I had a granddaddy that was named Absalom, I'd be a little, I'd make sure I was dressed up, looking my Sunday's best whenever I'm around him. But yeah, so that's, I mean, that's what we're going to talk about today is.
I don't think he wanted to do that. It was just who he was.
Yeah. Mm-hmm.
That there was an authority to him that he carried.
Yeah.
And in terms of our family, he was a lawgiver. And okay, that you learned and it was imparted to you.
Yeah.
Toe the line around this guy. You know.
He was a U.S. senator.
Don't be cutting up.
Yeah.
Yeah.
He was a senator?
He was a U.S. senator.
Okay. Yeah. And this is Pat's father.
Yes.
Okay. Cool. All right. Well, fear the Lord. What exactly?
What about you? When you would meet with your grandfather, what would happen?
I would say probably my great grandfathers held more of a, I mean, not to say that, you know, I don't respect my grandfathers because I certainly do. But they were both pretty, I would say like just Southern sweet type of thing. But my great grandfathers, I think they held more of a stern. I heard that so my dad's father's father, so on my dad's side, he was very, you know, strict, very, yes, like he was a boxer. So he, you know, toe the line. This was my grandfather Key. So this is the Key side. So yeah, I've definitely been around, you know, those types of individuals in my family.
You know, my grandfather was very loving at the same time.
Yeah.
I mean, he always made sure I got extra dinner. And, you know, if the watermelon was running out, he'd make sure I had plenty of watermelon.
Yeah.
So, it was interesting that he would keep an eye out for me and would watch over me tenderly.
Oh, yeah.
But at the same time, he had a presence.
Yeah.
And, you know, you snap too. You don't, you know, you're not cutting up over on the side.
Yeah. Well, would you say that's a good depiction of the Lord when referring to the fear of the Lord?
Well, what exactly does it mean? What does that, you know, it's interesting, the Greek word that translates the Hebrew word, the Greek is phobos, which is where we get phobia.
Wow.
So, I mean, there is a fear to that. And that is an accurate translation, the fear of the Lord. But there's a whole lot more to it, that it's reverential awe.
Yeah.
It's also another word for worship.
Really? Wow.
It's also the beginning of wisdom.
Yes, it is.
And so why are all these things tied to it? Why is the Messiah described in Isaiah chapter 11? His delight is the fear of the Lord.
Wow. Dang. That's really good.
So he has the spirit of the fear of the Lord. That's interesting that that's part of the gifts of the Holy Spirit, that you have this reverential awe.
Yeah.
You don't want to get out of line. You want to mind your P's and Q's. You want to do that.
Yeah, you want to
But
abide.
With the Messiah, it's his delight is the fear of the Lord. What delights him.
Mm-hmm.
You know, it's good to get into the mindset of why would Jesus go to the cross? And why would he volunteer for that? You know, what is that he was willing to submit? You know, there's an obvious parallel to Isaac. Isaac, the rabbis say, Isaac was 35 years old when Abraham was instructed to take him to the mountains of Moriah, to take him to Jerusalem, and there offer him as a sacrifice.
Gosh.
The rabbis like to remind us, well, Isaac had the ability to resist. You know, if I'm 35 and Abraham would have been 135, so
wow,
I'm thinking I can take him. I don't have to do this.
Yeah, seriously. Yeah, I can take them.
Jacob, wow. Isaac's son, obviously was told the story. And it's interesting he would use the dread of Isaac as something that would be part of a solemn pledge, that he would invoke the dread of Isaac in that. So as the knife is being raised and you're bound over an altar, the knife's in the air, what is going through your head? But that perfect submission of Isaac to the will of Abraham. Abraham's perfect submission to the will of God. And Hebrews says Abraham believed that God could raise Isaac back up from even an eyelash.
Wow.
So,
because it was a, like, I mean, they had to burn the sacrifice.
He was
going to
cut them into pieces and burn them. Which.
Jeez. I mean, people, read the Bible. I mean, jeez, this is wild. Like,
but for Jesus at the Last Supper, you know, this is the day he would sing Psalm 118. This is the day the Lord has made. I will rejoice and be glad in it. He's taking delight in the fear of the Lord. Mm-hmm. He is saying, I know this is why I'm here. I know this is why I'm born. So I'm fully man in this moment, and I'm taking delight in the fear of the Lord. Yeah. I know this is what he wants me to do.
Mm-hmm.
And he is saying, do you not understand? If I ask for it, my Father would give me 10,000 angels.
Mm-hmm.
I don't have to do this. But because I take delight in not my will, but your will be done.
Yeah, exactly.
I'm understanding this is the day the Lord has made. I will rejoice. Yes. I will be the willing sacrifice.
Mm-hmm.
I will lay down my life.
Yeah.
In our Christian walk, do we do that? You know, I've had some transcendent moments where I said, okay, but I'm not in that I die daily.
Mm-hmm.
You know, offenses come, and frankly, I get offended. I don't say, oh, what a wonderful opportunity for my love to be perfected.
Yeah,
I'm
I don't know
so
if I do that
glad
either.
I'm being purified in this moment. I'm not doing that. I'm having those human reactions, and I have to, you know, sort of wrestle with myself. What am I doing, and why am I doing this?
Yeah.
And then I guess the more important question, what is God doing, and what is he trying to show me?
Mm-hmm. Yeah.
These things aren't happening randomly.
Yeah,
I'm not saying God is causing all of them, but in his sovereignty, he's allowing free will to exercise in people around me. Mm-hmm. And so when that happens, when these offenses come, when whatever it is, what is my reaction to it? Mm-hmm. And in that reaction, am I saying, I want to honor God?
Yeah.
And unfortunately, I've got to say, many times I don't.
Mm-hmm.
Many times I react inappropriately.
Mm-hmm.
And I've got to, you know, go back and, God, I'm sorry.
Yeah, yeah.
Why did I do that?
Yeah, me too.
And, but then I get to, well, actually, the fear of the Lord leads to life. Mm-hmm. My negative reaction to a stimulus, I already know that leads to a place where I don't like Gordon. I don't like that response. Mm-hmm. I don't want that.
Yeah.
But if I act his way and according to his will, I already know that leads to life.
Yep. Yep.
So that obedience is better than sacrifice. The fear of the Lord is the beginning of wisdom.
Mm-hmm.
These things, I am over time really coming to understand this is a much better way for me to live.
Yeah, definitely.
You know, that old way doesn't lead to life. It leads to me being sorry again. And I don't want to be that.
Yeah.
Let's take the path that leads to life.
Yeah, amen. You mentioned some of the scriptures. So Proverbs 1:7, the fear of the Lord is the beginning of knowledge, but fools despise wisdom and instructions. There's another one, Proverbs 14:27. The fear of the Lord is a fountain of life, turning a person from the snares of death. And I have to, I guess, admit that when I hear the term the fear of the Lord, my mind automatically goes to the Old Testament. Because I feel like there's a lot, and this is just how I personally feel, I feel like there's a lot more examples to be fearful, reverential awe of the Lord in the Old Testament. Like, shout out to all the 90s babies out there if you're listening, or just parents and grandparents who watched The Prince of Egypt. Have you ever seen that movie?
Of course.
Okay. I love that movie. It's so good. And it just depicts that story so well. But I automatically, the first thing I thought of when I hear like fear of the Lord is in that movie when Moses sees the burning bush. And it's like the voice of God and just everything, like just transitions, and he's like float, and he, you know, it's holy ground, and the voice
take
of God, take off your sandals, this is holy ground. Like, I think of that because Moses was scared. He was like, oh my gosh, what is this? It's a burning bush. Like, this is crazy. This is the Lord. I don't know if that's right, though. I don't know if that's right to only think of the Old Testament fear of the Lord and assume that the Old Testament really depicts the fear of the Lord and the New Testament maybe depicts more of the love of God. What would you say?
I think the New Testament's got plenty about the fear of the Lord.
Yeah. You know, yeah.
Our God is a consuming fire, mm-hmm. is from the book of Hebrews.
Mm.
But let me give you one that you might connect with more.
Okay.
The Song of Mary. Luke chapter 1.
Mm-hmm. Yeah.
What does it say?
You know the spot. You know, I know what you're referring to, but I don't know the exact words. But it's after the angel comes to her and tells her, right? And then it's a praise. It's.
Yeah, but I just want to make sure everything's accurate.
Yes. Yes, indeed.
You know, us old guys, our memory isn't quite what it used to be. But I do remember it in, it's called the Magnificat, because my soul magnifies the Lord, is how it starts.
Mm-hmm.
But in verse 50, his mercy is on those who fear him from generation to generation.
Wow. Mm-hmm. Yep.
So do you want God's mercy on you, which is really New Testament?
Yeah.
I want his love. I want his mercy. Yep. I want his forgiveness. I want all of these things.
Mm-hmm.
Well, according to Mary, the precondition is
fear of the Lord.
The fear of the Lord.
Mm-hmm.
Now, here is a young girl. She's a teenager.
Mm.
And an angel appears to her and says, you're going to bear a child. In that culture, in that time, if you were pregnant and you weren't married, mm-hmm. what would happen?
You would die. You would be stoned.
Right.
Mm-hmm.
So it's interesting how God orchestrated things to make sure that she was protected.
Gosh, yeah.
But for an angel to tell you you're going to get pregnant, and then she says, how can this be? I mm-hmm. haven't known a man.
Mm-hmm. Mm-hmm.
And then the Spirit of the Lord will come upon you.
Wow.
In her response, be it unto me according to your word.
Yeah.
I think today we don't understand. Here's a teenager saying, I will lay down my life.
Wow. Mm. Mm-hmm.
It won't be my will.
Yeah. Which my will, yeah.
You know, what teenager today says, I'll give up everything. I'll give up my dream. I'll give up my aspirations. I will willingly submit to the shame.
Wow.
That's incredible. That shame followed.
Yeah.
You know, the Bible records that Jesus was accused of being born in sin.
Wow. Mm.
So, You know, Joseph had his own wrestling to do.
Yep.
I mean, he's a kind man, and he says, well, I'll put her away. Mm. I'll protect her.
Yeah.
I'll provide for her financially, but I'll put her away. Mm-hmm. Okay, the angel has to appear to him. He gets a revelation.
God's, yeah.
Mm-hmm. You know, there's something better.
Mm-hmm.
There's something better for you.
Yeah.
But his mercy is on those who fear him from generation to generation. Mm. And how God flows yeah. through generations that hold him in awe and hold him in reverence.
That's good.
If you treat the commandments casually, if you treat obedience casually, if you have presumption sins, if you have these things.
Well, what do you mean presumptuous sins?
God will forgive me.
Got it. So I'm just going to go ahead and sin. Got it.
Right. Mm-hmm. God will forgive me.
Mm-hmm.
We all do that.
Mm-hmm.
You can't. It's interesting how you can violate your conscience and get to the point where your conscience is seared, where it doesn't even bother you anymore.
Mm-hmm. Mm-hmm.
If you're still in the it bothers me,
mm-hmm.
then
yeah.
you're okay. When you get to the point where your conscience is seared, watch out, because Romans is quite clear. He will give you over to a reprobate mind.
Wow.
He will. Take his hand off of you and say, all right, if that's the way you want to go, then you've made your choice.
Mm-hmm.
But choose life. Why would you choose death? Choose life. The path that leads to life is that path of obedience, that path of saying, I understand the commandments. I understand the commandments aren't there to keep me from good things. They're there to keep me from bad things.
Mm-hmm. Exactly.
If I follow the commandments, I'm following the way of mm-hmm. life.
Mm-hmm.
His delight is in the fear of the Lord.
Mm-hmm.
You delight in that. It changes things. It changes your whole perspective.
Yep.
That I understand to have his mercy and have his compassion and to have these things. Mm-hmm. I want to take delight in observing the commandment.
Yeah. And I think in that, it's also a perspective of, you know, my life is not my own. It's not. The breath in my lungs belongs to you. I was created by you. So who am I to not follow the commandments of the Lord? They're for me. They're for me to live. The fear of the Lord is a fountain of life, turning a person from the snares of death. I mean, that then you think of Romans, sin leads to death. Who delivered us from sin?
Jesus,
exactly. So I think that's just a good reminder that we are not, my life is not my own. So as Mary would, Lord, what did she say? Be unto me.
Be it unto me.
Be it unto
according
me.
To according
your according
word.
To your word. Which is just so amazing. Like, and then I think of Jesus in the garden and he's praying and he's just, I mean, literally sweating blood, which is an actual condition, right? Like, science has proven that that can happen. Do you know about
I do know about that. And you get into that translation, was he sweating blood or was his sweat like blood? You know, it's obviously, it's a turmoil of soul that he's struggling within himself to get to that place of being obedient even unto the cross.
Yeah.
And that whole process, that prayer and that event is happening before he's arrested. So he's going to be, you know, kept in a prison cell within the high priest's house, which is interesting. The high priest's house would be engineered that way. But you can go to it and see a prison cell in the basement.
That is wild.
Of a house that was presumably part of a priest's complex.
Mm.
So why they have that? They have that for religious trials.
Wow. Mm-hmm.
So the next day he's delivered into the religious trial, and from there delivered unto Pontius Pilate.
So is it okay to assume that to fear the Lord means to be afraid of him?
Yeah.
Now,
I think a better way is to be afraid of the consequences of sin.
Okay, now I'm going to play, I don't like to say devil's advocate. I'm going to say angel's advocate. So playing angel's advocate, those who hear that and say, okay, well, the New Testament says, and the word says, you know, perfect love casts out fear. We have not been given a spirit of fear. We've been given power, love, and a sound mind. So how do we translate that fear being okay?
How do you? Are you supposed to love sin?
No.
Yeah, you know, be afraid of the consequences of sin. Mm. Be afraid of being cut off. Be afraid of losing fellowship.
Mm-hmm.
You know, the gifting, the calling is without repentance. Mm-hmm. But, you know, what happens when your sins separate you from God?
Mm.
You know, it happened to David. The Holy Spirit wasn't taken from him. His kingdom wasn't taken from him.
Mm-hmm.
What was taken was the joy of his salvation.
The delight. Mm-hmm.
So, I don't know about you. I really like joy.
Me too. Yeah.
I think joy is great.
Yes.
I think life is great.
Mm-hmm.
You know, l'chaim. And... You know, let's celebrate life.
Yeah.
And let's take the path that leads to life. Let's not take the path that leads to death.
Mm-hmm.
So just the two big commandments, love the Lord your God with all your heart, and have that echo, if you love me, keep my commandments.
Yeah.
And then love your neighbor as yourself.
Mm-hmm.
This isn't, well, you know, I'm keeping the commandments, therefore I get to judge you. No,
mm-hmm.
It's not that. You know, let's go on the road to life together.
Yeah.
How can I encourage people? How can I bring people? How can I let them know the same mercy and compassion that I've received? You can have it too.
Yeah.
You know, if you confess your sins, he is faithful and just to forgive you. And it's a wonderful plus, and cleanse you from all unrighteousness, mm-hmm. make you brand new all over again.
Mm-hmm.
And you get to have that every morning. His mercy is new every morning.
That's right.
You can have it every single day.
Mm-hmm.
Why not have it?
Mm-hmm.
Why not follow that? And not just follow it, but follow hard after it.
Mm.
Take delight in the Lord.
Yeah.
Take delight in the fear of the Lord.
Yeah.
And it's not fear of him as a person, because he's full of mercy and love and compassion.
Yeah.
He wants to bless you. He wants to bless the generations following you. He wants good things for you. He wants you to live in a garden with him for all eternity.
Yes.
That's what he wants.
Yep. Mm-hmm.
He wants that.
Mm-hmm.
Fear the consequences of sin.
Yeah. That's good. That's a good perspective.
Live your life so that God has a choice to give you mercy.
Wow. Somebody write that down. That's good. Live your life
so that God has a choice.
So that God has a choice.
To give you mercy.
Mm. Yes. Yes, and amen. Choose mercy. Amen. Well, how can a person who's watching or listening live, I don't know if this is the right way to say it, but live in the fear of the Lord every day?
Well, one of the easiest ways is read the Bible.
Yeah, well, that's good. Yeah.
Seriously.
Yeah.
Read the Bible. I'm reading through Ezekiel. I'm kind of stuck right now because I just feel bad. It's like, wait a minute. You know, if this is going on in Israel back in Ezekiel's day, what in the world does God think of the current state of mankind?
Mm.
You know, we are messing up. And it just the weight of it comes, and you go, wow.
Mm-hmm.
And I'm seeing a lot of parallels in American culture to Roman culture.
Mm. Wow.
Parts of it give me encouragement. Christianity flourished in that.
Yeah.
But at the same time, it was hard to flourish.
Mm.
There was persecution. If you're a Christian, you're not received into open society.
Mm-hmm.
So, you know, do I want to live in that culture? I think within me, no, I don't. I'd much rather live in a culture that honors God
mm-hmm.
and has that fear of the Lord. But yeah. I think as a culture, we've completely lost the fear of God.
Yeah.
There is no more sense that, you know, when I, you know, swear on the Bible, that it has any kind of meaning personally.
Wow. Mm-hmm. Mm-hmm.
And we see it in our leaders. We see it in our, you know, anyone who has any influence, whether it's in sports or entertainment or music. Or, I mean, there are obvious notable exceptions that are really wonderful.
Mm-hmm.
But at the same time, I mean, do we even trust what our politicians say anymore? Do we even think that there's an adherence to truth, and that there is such a thing as objective truth?
Mm-hmm.
These things all seem very far from us.
Yeah. Do you think it's because, you know, the church that, for example, like my parents went to, in their words, was all about hellfire and brimstone. Like, if you do not accept the Lord, I mean, they preached hell more than they preached about, like, the mercy of God, right? So I think moving to where we're at today, the church, well, in moving away from that, it's like they've preached too much mercy and not enough about the truth that there is hell, you know, which if you talk about hell, you get kind of like afraid. Like, I don't want to go to hell.
Well,
so
who talked about hell more than anyone else in the Bible?
Jesus.
Why?
Because he was like, get it together, people. Believe in me, because there's a way out.
Right.
There's a way out, and I don't want you to perish. I don't want you to suffer. I don't want you to be led into this eternity of despair. You know, I want you to be with me.
And what was the whole mission of John the Baptist?
To prepare the way, to tell people.
Right, to turn from their sins.
Mm-hmm.
I mean, he was all about, you know, reform your ways. And you look at his sermons, he had specific things for people to do to sort of repair their relationship with God and do that on the basis of human effort in order to make the way straight so that when the Messiah came, they would see it and understand it.
Mm-hmm.
Have we gotten too casual in church? And, you know, the phrase is hyper grace. We overemphasize the grace and mercy of God.
Mm-hmm.
So essentially, I as a Christian can live how I want, mm-hmm. and then Sunday go back and say, "Okay, God, I'm sorry."
Yeah.
And okay.
And that's what I was trying to get to, was like, do you think that's why we've lost the fear of the Lord? Is because
we don't preach it.
Yeah.
I can't say it's one particular thing.
Mm-hmm.
You know, when the church loses the presence of God, then what happens is the world will invade the church.
Mm. That's
when the church has the presence of God, then nothing can prevail against it.
Amen. Yeah.
The presence of God advances from the church to the culture.
Yep. Mm-hmm.
And as a cultural Christianity in America, have we lost the fear of the Lord?
Mm-hmm.
And I think you can say with some certainty, yeah.
Absolutely.
We have. I mean, we, instead of the beginning of wisdom, it's the beginning of stupidity, where what in the world are we doing?
Yeah.
And why are we allowing this?
Mm-hmm.
Why are we turning, you know, so far away from God that it's sort of, you know, unrecognizable. Mm. But the wonderful thing is God's always calling us back.
Yeah.
And he's always giving us an opportunity to turn.
Yeah.
And to say, okay, let's come back. can in that turning and emphasis of the fear of the Lord, can we get judgmental and condemning? The answer is yes. Mm. And is that a fault of the church in times past? I think the answer is yes. Mm-hmm. You know, should we be reaching out to the oppressed, the ones who are stuck in sinful mm-hmm. patterns, mm-hmm. and letting them know there's a better way?
Yeah.
That's exactly what the church in the first century did.
Yeah.
That's they what, were in a yeah. Roman culture that mm-hmm. was completely given over
to lots of things.
So, yeah. mm-hmm. okay.
And Jesus said, I came for the sick, not the healthy.
Right.
Yeah.
So let's, you know, instead of saying we don't want the sick and the sinner in our midst, mm-hmm. we've got it wrong.
Yeah.
Or we preach condemnation to them.
Yeah.
If you're doing this, instead of saying, hey, mm-hmm. you know, there's a better way.
Yeah.
You know, I spent a couple of decades in full bore rebellion. You didn't have yeah. to tell me I was a sinner.
Oh, wow. Come on and preach. Mm-hmm.
I knew that.
Mm-hmm.
At the end of it, what I needed mm-hmm. and God in his mercy gave me
yeah.
was someone who said, I was like you. Mm. I know where you are. I see you. I'm here to tell you, you can come out.
That's good, yeah.
You can come back. Mm-hmm. The parable of the prodigal, guess who that's for? Mm-hmm. That really connected. And they didn't just speak it. They said, I want to live it. I want you to come and hang out with me.
That's good, yeah.
I know what you're doing. Mm-hmm. I want you to come and, yeah.
Mm-hmm.
Let me show you another way. They weren't coming to participate with me. They were coming to say, well, hey, there's a better way. Mm-hmm. And in that love and in that outreach, mm-hmm. I turned.
Yeah.
So that's really good to do.
Mm-hmm.
You know, that's the ministry of Jesus.
Yeah.
He didn't have to go to Zacchaeus and say, well, what you're doing as a tax collector is wrong. Mm. He didn't do that. You know, he says to Zacchaeus, come down from that tree. Tonight, I'm having dinner with you.
At your house.
And the mere yeah. presence. It's amazing
yeah.
what he proclaims at that very dinner. The rabbi has come. Jesus has come. Here's what I'm going to do. Mm. And he starts talking restoration. He starts talking, I'm going to live a different life.
Wow.
I'm going to do it right this time.
That's what Zacchaeus said.
Yeah. Mm,
that's really cool. And it was the love of God too. I mean, thinking about your experience in India, it was the love of God that really hit you. Not the condemnation, but the love.
When Jesus appeared to me at the Godavari River and he showed me how much he loved a woman who was in idolatry, it was obvious he was also me.
Yeah, yeah, yeah.
It was a baptism in love. And I know these are, mm-hmm. you know, Christianese. I don't have words in the natural that will explain it. You have to experience it.
Mm-hmm. Yeah.
It's kind of like if you've never been swimming, you don't know what it's like.
Mm-hmm.
So go jump in the deep end of the pool. I jumped into a deep end of an ocean.
Mm.
You can't come to the end of it.
Yeah, wow.
I had an experience that absolutely rocked me.
Mm-hmm.
Jesus wasn't just somebody in a book or somebody that a preacher was talking about.
Mm-hmm.
Wow, this, you're real.
Mm-hmm, mm-hmm.
You know, I've seen yeah. evidence, I've seen healings, I've seen deliverance, I've mm-hmm. seen these things.
Mm-hmm.
But here I am experiencing you, and not only that, but you really want to be with me.
Yeah, yeah. Mm-hmm.
You really want me?
Yeah.
And it's like Zacchaeus. You really?
Yeah.
You want to have dinner with me?
Wow. Yeah.
It's when you get that, then the response back, well, I'm all in.
Yeah, exactly.
Okay.
Yeah, it's not my life, but it's yours.
Yeah, you had me at hello.
Yeah, yeah, yeah.
Was, yeah. Mm-hmm.
How did you, and now this is, I mean, kind of off topic, but not really. How did you not get overtaken by like the condemnation that you might have felt for being rebellious?
Oh, I went through a whole thing of, you know, I got to confess all my sins and stuff. Mm-hmm. It was great. My mom and dad took me aside and said, Gordon, stop. Because, yeah. I wanted to get all that stuff out.
Yeah.
And I didn't want to have secrets.
Yep. Yep.
Secrets mm-hmm. kill you.
Mm-hmm. Absolutely.
You know, I do have a phrase, confession is good for the soul.
Yeah.
It's bad for the reputation. Mm-hmm. So make mm-hmm. sure you pick and choose.
Yeah.
And make sure you trust, because mm-hmm. you are. You're putting it on the line.
Mm-hmm.
So find that trust and find those relationships where you can be real. You don't have to pretend.
Yeah.
And that's what I love about true community, true yes. Christian community.
Yeah.
You can be real.
Absolutely.
Here's what I'm struggling with.
Yeah.
And you're not expected, well, God's got a special hot fire for you, and you're gonna burn hot. And please, you know, don't come around anymore.
Yeah, yeah.
The extension of mm-hmm. love, the extension of grace, where you're mirroring what God wants to
Absolutely.
Do.
Absolutely, yeah. That's the beauty of community, and you can't do it alone. Get community. All right, let's look at another scripture. This is Psalm 111:10. The fear of the Lord is the beginning of wisdom, which you have mentioned. All who follow his precepts have good understanding. To him belongs eternal praise.
So what do you get out of that verse?
Yeah, so follow his precepts. I also, like this psalm reminds me of another psalm. I can't remember which one it is, but David is asking, how can a young person stay pure in its... by obeying or listening to the word or something like
Psalm
that.
Psalm 119.
Yeah. By listening to the word. So, again, and this reiterates, the fear of the Lord is the beginning of wisdom, right? All who follow his precepts have good understanding. To him belongs eternal praise. It's life, you know? But I think more than that, I'm also reminded of something that I posted on my Instagram. I reposted it because I saw it and I was like, wow, that's really good. And it spoke to me. And it's the gospel is not behave, it's behold. Because out of that beholding of your beloved, Jesus, once you realize and receive who he is, who you are in him, you want to follow his precepts. You want to walk in righteousness, peace, and joy. And you only walk in that with him, by him, and through him. And so I just think, behold him. And really, the fear of the Lord is beholding him, right? You're in awe and reverence of him. And you're like, wow, you're amazing. Like, I'm speechless. Lord, here I am. Here I am. Send me. Here I am. Speak. Your servant is listening.
The more you look for him, the more revelation you get.
Yeah.
You're on to a deep theological truth that goes to what Pilate said to Jesus. Mm. Ecce homo, behold the man.
Wow.
So he's presenting the sacrifice to the people, and he's presenting him beaten, mm-hmm. scourged. And he says, behold the man. Mm. That, it's odd how God speaks through people in the middle of them doing something absolutely horrific.
Mm. Mm-hmm.
You know, the high priest prophesying, it is better for one man to die than the whole nation to perish.
Wow. Mm-hmm.
And what he was doing is, I'm more afraid of Rome than I am of recognizing the miracles and the Messiah could be standing in front of me.
Wow.
If we proclaim him king, if we proclaim him Messiah, Rome is going to come down hard. Mm. And so he says, it is better for one man to die than the whole nation to perish. He's mm-hmm. using something that greater good mm-hmm. it would be how it's, you know, the best for the most number of people. Mm-hmm. He's having a very human reaction, but he's also proclaiming a deep spiritual truth that when the Messiah dies and offers his soul as a sacrifice
exactly.
for sin, mm-hmm. billions of people are going to come into the kingdom of God. Mm. It's these phrases from the Bible that are instructions for us. So for Pilate to say, behold the man, he is asking us to behold the humanity of Jesus. Mm. Behold his stripes, his wounds, his crown of thorns, the mocking, the despising, the Savior who is absolutely touched with what you're going through. Mm-hmm. And is doing it willingly.
Mm-hmm. Wow.
And is standing there bleeding for you. Mm-hmm. Mm-hmm. But behold him also in the theophanies. Behold him as seated at the right hand of the Father praying. Behold him as Savior, mm-hmm. as King. Messiah, as King. Mm-hmm. All of these things, all of the attributes, the more you look at them, the more you get encouraged.
Absolutely.
And it's no longer a personal struggle. I've got to fight and I've got to mm-hmm. overcome with my will. Mm-hmm. You come into that place, let your will be done.
Yeah.
I see your will now.
Yeah.
I see what you've accomplished. I see that you can do this.
Yeah.
I behold it.
Yeah.
And therefore, I want to be that.
Exactly.
And when you want that, then it's not willpower anymore.
Mm, yeah. It's the spirit. Amen. Amen.
And it is a spirit.
Yeah.
And that's one of the attributes of the Messiah in chapter 11 of the book of Isaiah. Mm-hmm. He has the spirit of knowledge and of the fear of the Lord.
Wow. That is so amazing. I didn't even... Honestly, I don't think I've ever heard that scripture about the Messiah delighting in the fear of the Lord.
I know you've read Isaiah.
I mean, I have. Maybe not all. Have I read? Yeah, I have. I have. Isaiah. What is it? Isaiah what?
11.
Isaiah 11. Okay. Isaiah 11, everyone. That's really good. I think, how should people, when they hear the fear of the Lord, what should they be hearing?
Reverential awe. Mm-hmm. Here, you know, behold the goodness and the severity of God. Mm. That, you know, both are there. Why is the cross necessary? It's because God is just. He cannot deny that.
Yeah. Yep.
And in that justice, the whole universe is asking for justice. He has to have the sacrifice. Yeah. Just what Abraham predicted, God has prepared the lamb for the sacrifice. The lamb slain from the beginning of time. Mm-hmm. These things have been on his heart because mm-hmm. he knew that we would mess it up.
Yeah.
And he was making sure, you know, don't go far because mm-hmm. I'm making a way. Mm-hmm. I'm making a way back.
Yeah.
And in that, restoring that balance where he can extend mercy, but he's done so justly.
Yep. Yes and amen. I think you're preaching.
I think I am.
All right. Well, I mean, that's really, you know, it for today. I think we've touched on it. And I just pray that people aren't turned off, for lack of a better term, when they hear fear of the Lord.
Well, actually, I hope they are turned on by it.
Exactly.
Because it is the beginning of wisdom. It is the beginning of knowledge of him. Mm-hmm. And it really starts to help you understand, why did Jesus come?
Exactly.
And why did he offer himself? Mm-hmm. What was that all about? Why is the willingness of Mary an illustration for us? Let us be it unto me according to your word. Mm-hmm. why is obedience to the commandments so very relevant for Christians today?
Yeah.
You know, we want to really quote, now there is no more law. So I'm not saying, well, let's go out and observe the dietary laws and let's observe all the festivals and and let's get the date right and let's go out and set a watch and when the sun goes down on Friday night. I'm not saying do that, but I am saying the observance of the commandments. Can we keep the Big Ten? And can we just keep the Big Two?
Right, yes.
Can we keep love God with all of your heart, love your neighbor as yourself.
Yeah.
And if you do that, you fulfill all the law and the prophets.
Yeah.
Can we at least do that? Mm-hmm. Within the Christian community today, I'm hearing a lot of hate. I'm hearing a lot of rejection that if you don't toe the line, and I'm not even talking doctrinal issues, I'm talking political issues. And if you don't toe the line, then you're dead to me. And I'm going to shun you and exclude you. And, you know, if you don't follow my pathway on masks and vaccines and which candidate to support, what happened, and you don't do all of these things, you know, where is loving your neighbor in that?
Where's the fear of the Lord in that?
Amen.
Exactly.
Now you're preaching.
Amen. Amen. All right. Well, let's close this out in prayer, because I also feel like people can get caught up in like the religiosity of the fear of the Lord, which I mean, I think we touched on with hellfire and brimstone, that sort of thing. And really, I just think back to that quote, the gospel is not about behave, it's about behold. And that comes against that spirit of religion.
Well, the behold leads to behave.
Exactly. Exactly. So it's not that, then behold.
If you put your actions first and say, well, I'm going to do right and God's going to pay attention to me, then you got the wrong.
Exactly.
That's not the right path. The right path is behold the man, behold Jesus. The sacrifice, behold his love, how great his love is.
Yeah.
And in that beholding, your behavior changes. You become new again.
Mm-hmm. Yeah. All right. Well, let us pray.
You pray.
All right. I'm going to pray. All right, Lord Jesus, we behold you, Lord. We just worship you, Lord. You are King. You are Savior. You are Creator. You are the Ancient One, the Holy One of Israel. You are our Beloved, and we are yours. Thank you, Jesus, for leaving the 99 for the one. Thank you, Jesus, for delivering us from a life of sin, from death, from disease. By your stripes, Lord Jesus, we are healed. And so we just take hold of these truths today, Lord God. And we behold you, the man, the Son of Man, the Son of God, Righteous One, the Lamb of God, the Lion of the tribe of Judah. Thank you, Jesus. And Lord, I just pray in your name, Jesus, that everyone who's watching and listening, myself, Gordon, that we just begin to just fear you on a new level, Lord, that we desire to behold you, that we desire to listen and obey your word, your commands, your precepts, Lord, because we know, not just in our mind, but in our hearts, that that is where life is. That is where it is. That's where love is, God. And I pray that this isn't coming out of a religious spirit, Lord, but it's coming out of the Spirit of God. It's coming from love. It's coming from your love, Abba, and nothing else. And I just pray, Lord, that today, that the seeds of faith that have been thrown, it falls on good soil in our hearts, God, and it takes root as we just continue to grow and be rooted and grounded in your love, Jesus. We thank you, Lord. We praise your name, Lord. In Jesus' name, amen and amen.
Amen.
All right. Well, we ended, look at this, 51 minutes.
All right.
All right, guys. Well, next week, we are going to be talking about Agenda of Angels.
Agenda of Angels.
Yeah, that is the topic that someone commented in. So we're just going to dive into that. I'm not really sure. I was really expecting you to understand.
What's up with angels?
What's up with angels? Yeah, I think, we're going to talk about angels.
He's placed his angels guard over you.
Yes. Yes, he has. We each have at least two, right?
Yeah.
At least
plural.
Two. Plural. Yes. All right. So that's what we're going to be talking about. Make sure you guys tune in. Thank you so much for watching. Thank you to everyone who continues to comment. Just really encouraging things. I love seeing those comments. So thank you. And we will see you next week.